Hello everyone out there in Twitch TV land, and welcome to yet another Waystone Games live stream. I am Pluto, Brad Pluto Ramey, Assistant Community Manager here at Waystone Games, and we have the first episode of a brand new series that we're going to be trying to do here, an edutainment series, where we're going to try to be educational and entertaining, and hopefully we'll teach some of you guys how to do certain things. So the premise of the show, as I mentioned in the Reddit thread, is every other week, so this week being the first week, we are going to be choosing someone from the community via a Reddit thread to teach how to play a specific shaper and also a specific kind of archetype or role and what have you. So, for example, this first week, Damned Scholar. Congratulations, Damned Scholar, on having been selected. He's waiting in the wings in the game and on Skype for us to come and talk to him and teach him how to play Kinsu this week. and also how to do things that, you know, all ranged carries should know how to do. Today's focus is going to be on kiting and kind of animation canceling, or as the Dota term refers to it, as orb walking. excuse me. So what's going to be done is we'll do the normal community catch-up kind of Wednesday thing where we're going to talk about what you guys are talking about for a little bit on the Reddit and whatnot, and then we'll jump right into a game with Damned Scholar. Zakint is going to be our kind of our target dummy for the most part, and we will teach you guys a few things, hopefully about animation canceling, kiting, orb walking, and about Kinsu in general as well. So, of course, without further ado, do you want to pick a spell, Brad? Don't do it. Thanks, DLS. Let's go and see what you guys are talking about in the community. Boom. That doesn't show anything. Fantastic. Hold on. One sec, guys. Let me get this screen region. Boom. Boom. There we go. Perfect. All right. So, again, another Wednesday rolls around, and with another Wednesday, we have another page of the Dawngate Chronicles. This page featuring the much awaited arrival of Freya. Fenmore we saw in Monday's page, looking all badass. But here we see Freya and Fenmore finally kind of meet. And a lot of people are discussing on Reddit and stuff that it's almost heartbreaking to see this. You know, it's the feels. It's the feels. Because as many of you know, if you don't, spoilers, I guess. Fenmore and Freya don't really like each other because Fenmore destroys Freya's entire village, and she's now known as Freya the Survivor, and she kind of doesn't like Fenmore. Of course, asking where's Fenmore is one of her key phrases that you guys may have heard. But yeah, the feels in this page kind of, but the feels that they are going to be leading to, that we all know about their story and stuff, hashtag feelsgate. But, you know, Freya, I love how Nick describes Freya and kind of arted up Freya here. She looks so fun and so innocent and so, like, just, like, this panel right here of handing the box, glad I found you, is, like, such a nice, sweet, and sincere face that it's just like, God, she has no idea what's coming, you know? And, like, is it dramatic irony or situational irony? I think it's dramatic irony where, like, the audience kind of knows something that the characters don't, but it hasn't happened yet, so maybe it's not dramatic irony. I don't know. But anyway, that is kind of the discussion. The big thing that people are noticing as well is that these are obviously the badges of the nine people that are part of the nine, and there's a little blood on the fourth. There's a little bit of blood on the fourth. So people notice that, and they've been talking about that, of course, in the thread. They've been talking about the feels gate, all that kind of stuff. But they've also noticed that in page 5 of the Dawngate Chronicles, there was actually kind of a tease of this. Some people noticed, some people did not. If you did not know, in page 5 of the Dawngate Chronicles, this guy was actually, where is it? Let me go back. In the background of one of the panels. So you can see him right here. Boom. Look at that, right over Idolus's shoulder. What? Is that an Easter egg? Damn. And so now you see his badge being bloodied. What could it mean for our young number 4 right here? You guys will have to just wait and find out. Definitely check out the Dawngate Chronicles every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday as they're beautifully drawn and beautifully written. But yeah. Idolist number 1. Oh, could it be? We actually had a talk, me, Dibs, Sam London, and Chris Latois, Well, we all three confronted Chrysota and said, Dibs has to be number one. Like, Dibs needs to be the guy that is running the whole parade, the evil, evil parade. And I think that would be the greatest thing in the world. And Dibs, Dan Gibson, lead champion designer, also mentioned that in his mind, and in pretty much reality, Dibs is theoretically like the strongest shaper in the world because he could just dream. Like his carrot skin, Dibs, his carrot skin, if you guys didn't read the lore about it, it was hilarious. There was like a festival, and I think it was like Mara and Zeri were there, and Dibs showed up, and he looked like a carrot, and Mara was like, "Are you a carrot?" And she like touched him, and she was like, he is an actual literal carrot. He was not like dressed up like a carrot. He was not like painted like a carrot. He literally turned himself into a carrot because he's the dreamer. And because if he dreams it, he can do it. So theoretically, according to Dibs, the Shaper Dibs could just dream like, I want to be the most powerful person in the world and just murder everyone. And that would be it. So it's funny because the smallest, most adorable character in the game could also be the most powerful. So, yes, that's pretty awesome. The other thing we wanted to address is we've been seeing a lot of these threads pop up of having some people having some ping issues or some latency issues since the last patch. We want you guys to know that we are aware of it and we are looking into it. Nothing much more to say about that at the moment, but yeah, I just wanted to make sure you guys knew that we are aware of it. New content. Of course, you know, with another week comes another piece of content. This week we released the Death Talon Vianna, also the Hingeman Viridian, and the Ugger Ward, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, the Ugger Ward, the other Ugger Camp Ward. So check out those skins. Of course, Arl John from MOBA Champion did a great job of coming in and taking some sweet screenshots for you guys of all the abilities. You can find out more information, obviously, at MOBAChampion.com. But yeah, thanks to him for doing that. Look at these sweet, sweet skins. And of course, Viridian just is cool as hell. And then, of course, with Viridian comes this mindset that, you know, Careful Houndoom is talking about right here of, whenever a brand new Shaper comes out, there is this kind of rush, this like mad rush to play them. And, I just wanted to kind of tell you guys that it's okay. People are going to be new. It's going to be a lot of people's first time Viridians are going to happen over the next week. You know, if you see a dev picking Viridian, they probably played it before. I've played Viridian before. You know, a lot of us have played Viridian before, obviously, internally. But outside of that, there aren't many people that have played Viridian. And so just be patient with them. Let them learn. There is no, like, they can go into a custom game and stuff, but there's also the fact that we don't have bots to really practice again. If you want to practice against, if you want to play against someone, you have to have, you know, a friend to go in a custom game with you and stuff. So just be very patient with those new players, people that are playing Viridian for the first time. It really, that kind of goes to every Shaper. Like, if someone comes in and say, this is my first time Volek, but I've been playing for a while, give them benefit of the doubt and allow them to teach them. If you know something about Volek, like if you've played Viridian a lot, let's say you've been spamming Viridian for the past, 24, 48 hours, and you know something that they may not know, that they don't seem to be knowing, offer the advice. You know, just ask them if they would like some help. You know, don't force it upon them, obviously, because that can be misconstrued as pushy and stuff like that. But just let it be patient with people trying out new things for the first time. That's my message there. And then, of course, these threads always really amuse me. Their Viridian versus our Viridian. We had their Kensu versus our Kensu, stuff like that. And they're just really funny, just kind of juxtapositions of a badass fish and not badass fish is kind of how it is for Viridian, which is funny. Kensu, I know, was cat, so it was like badass cat versus not badass cat. Sadly, the thread hasn't 100% taken off yet with people putting their input in, because most people in this thread are just commenting that he misspelled, he used the wrong version of their. He used they are, the contraction, rather than their possessive. So good job, Young Bake. But the thought is there. So thank you for making this thread. So if you guys have examples of their awesome Viridian versus our crappy Viridian, please go ahead and post it in there. It's always a fun little thing. And then, of course, there was this thread, too. We wanted to, you know, say that, welcome everyone to the Dawngate dev team. But, yeah, again, we are aware of this bug. We're looking into it. All the orange people you see on your friends list may not actually be devs. But Yeah, just something that happens. Beta's going to bait. That's how it works. Things are going to break whenever we make changes to certain things. And apparently this one was that people's names were appearing as orange, which was weird and peculiar. But we know about it, and we're looking into it. So thanks for the patience. And then the last one, unintentional spoilers from the dev stream. So this was during the Viridian reveal, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. You guys saw this kind of stuff, the level editor, quick game, bots off, spectate bots, stuff like that. These are features that the level editor is something completely internal that, you know, obviously will never be be public. But these are quick buttons for us to get into certain game types and stuff. So if you want to do a solo game, we hit the quick game button. If you want to look at bots, we hit spectate game, spectate bots. If we want to play with bots, we hit play with bots or whatever. These are features that we have been 100% transparent, just like Zwill is saying here, that you guys know we're working on bots. You guys know we're working on spec mode. This isn't really a this shouldn't particularly be taken as a sign of them being ready. You know, like, this is stuff that it will take months to iron out, get the kinks out of, you know, all that kind of stuff. But we have to have a way as devs to go in and you know, QA it and test it and make sure and run it through its paces before obviously we give it to you guys. That's the most important part to us. So yes, spectate and bots are coming. We've said that a million times, so we're excited to give them to you eventually whenever they're ready. So hopefully you guys are hyped for that. But I think that is pretty much it as far as kind of the community roundup is concerned. I think we will just get into the game, but first let me Damn Scholar says his nose has been running a bit. If I go silent for several seconds, I probably muted myself to blow it. All right, so we have six Scholar to teach right now. Let me get that boy George in here on the Skype call. You guys are all excited for the Skype ringing noise. It's the best. What's up, George?
Hello. Whoop.
Yeah, you're good.
All right, fantastic. I'm going to probably just mute myself.
Okay, but guys, this is George Zakint-Liu, of course, our other assistant community manager that's going to be taking some of the shots for us today. So thanks for being here. Thanks for being our test dummy, George. We appreciate it.
That's sad.
Let me get Damned Scholar in here. Mm-mm-mm. Calling him right now. Hopefully he answers. Is he there?
I'm here.
Hello, sir. How are you doing?
I'm all right. I hate the Skype ringing noise.
Yeah, everyone hates the Skype ringing noise. That's why I'm usually on Do Not Disturb, but, you know, when you call someone, you can't really avoid it. So this is Damn Scholar. Welcome to the stream.
Hey,
that's good. That's a good introduction. why don't you just tell people out there, hopefully they can hear you. Let me make sure that you are loud enough. Tell people who you are, what got you into Dawngate, and you know, what inspired you to actually sign up for this crazy, crazy coaching lesson.
I'm a relatively new MOBA player. I actually played a lot of StarCraft back in high school, the original StarCraft. So I played a lot of use map settings maps. So I had a lot of experience on the first maps that inspired Dota, back before MOBAs were actually a thing. Mm. But then I got out of that, got into other video games, and kind of didn't look back. I knew about Dota when it was a thing, but then I didn't get into MOBAs until just recently when I decided to check them out, see how they'd grown. Mm-hmm. So I decided to choose between League of Legends or Dota 2, decided to go with League, and I've been getting steadily more addicted.
Okay.
For the past few months.
So did you ever play, like, Aeon of Strife and stuff, pretty much?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
I played Aeon of Strife, not Dota 2. Not the original Dota.
Okay. Ever, cool. Well, what inspired you to sign up for this? Did you just want to become a little bit better? Do you like Kensu, but, like, don't really know how to play him, or what is it?
I was really enthused for Kensu's kit, to be honest. Back from the lore bit that we got as a teaser for him, because I really like ranged carries who are ability heavy, but I can't really play him that well because he also requires a lot of kiting skill, and that's an area where I've always been weak. Like in League, I'll play ranged carries who rely on their abilities, and then I won't auto attack people because I can't function in auto attack range, so I just use the abilities. And that works out pretty well if you're playing Sivir and you maximize your Boomerang Blade's damage, but doesn't work nearly as well with Kensu. But okay. I really like his kit. I love all the utility that he brings to the table. And I've seen people make some absolutely ridiculous plays with the Thrill of the Hunt dash.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I just love to be able to play him like that.
Okay. Well, hopefully I will do my best to make you a better Kensu player. I will try. Again, guys, you know, this is our first kind of foray into this kind of one-on-one coaching scenario. So my first time, this is the stream's first time, this is everyone's first time. So let's be gentle. Let's just get right into it. Let me go ahead and start the game. Boom. I'm going to select Kensu. So we have, I'm going to be on my own team because we can't obviously have two Kensus on one team, and we'll have Damned Scholar and Zakynt on the enemy team. Let me choose my stuff. So to go over kind of perks and roles and stuff like that, as a range carry, I really enjoy playing Gladiator. Obviously, I come from playing AD carry like in League of Legends and stuff, so I enjoy the farming mini game, kind of. I enjoyed it a lot whenever you had to keep up Gladiator stacks. It was really, really enjoyable, really, really fulfilling and rewarding to do so. Since we've changed it, still, it's all about farming. It's very important to farm, and as far as my perk and loadout is concerned, I run this page that I've, appropriately named AD Carry. It's one defense pin, 11.2 power, 11 armor, and Ravager. I really like Ravager. Duelist is also a fantastic option for range carries because obviously you're doing a lot of your damage with your basic attack. So having it kind of amp up over time is really, really strong. A Ravager, kind of the same effect. You're gaining more power as you continually do damage and use abilities and stuff in combat, but it's a little bit smaller of a Spirit Stone itself. Duelist takes up a majority of the page, so Ravager allows you to fit a few extra additional shapes in there, and with those shapes I filed in some armor. I really like doing armor just because if I'm against another range carry in lane, our trades, so especially as Kensu, like Kensu versus like a Mikella, let's say, just walking up to each other and right-clicking once, Kensu's going to get both of his autos off, and Mikella's only going to get one. If I have armor on top of both of my autos, like, I have the advantage in offense and defense, if that makes sense. So I'm getting off two autos to her one, and I'm taking less damage from her one auto than she is from my two autos. So that's it's a pretty big bonus, and allows you to win trades more effectively throughout the early game, which is where, you know, trading mostly matters. Everyone must cooperate. In addition, let me actually turn down the sound just a hair. I don't want it to be too loud. All right. In addition, you know, as far as laning is concerned, you know, getting off effective trades is really, really important, obviously. You want to get in and be able to deal more damage than they can deal to you and get out safely. That requires you to know their abilities. It also requires you to know not only how much damage you can output, which is important, but how much damage they can output on you. Because you don't want to go in on a trade for someone with someone that is maybe like started power, full Ravager stacks, and a Mikella that is on her third gold standard, right? Like, that's just not a smart trade at all. Because, you know, Mikella's gold standard does the increasing more damage for her next three autos, her third one dealing the most damage. So if I started Hunger, let's say, and I haven't attacked anything, so I don't have Ravager, and she has full Ravager, started power, and her third gold standard, that's probably not a good trade for me to take, because it's going to hurt a whole heck of a lot. I'm going to start power and a few potions. We'll just go to top lane. We'll farm a little bit. Not competitively, per se. Just want to get up in level so we have all of our abilities, and then we can start kind of really going into kiting and animation canceling and stuff like that. So I do start with Q first on Kensu. I like the extra damage that it puts on my arrows. 10 plus 2 bonus magical damage. 12, but when you attack someone twice, that's going to add up to 24, which is, puts me up to 81 total kind of damage put on the target. Pre-mitigation, of course. But as far as CSing is concerned, one thing that I will kind of let you guys know about as far as like the kiting and animation canceling is concerned, I like to do it all the time. And that's just so that I have the muscle memory and I'm already in the mindset of orb walking. So to explain to you guys kind of what that concept is, if I were to simply attack move, let me talk about attack move for a sec. So attack move is when you right click, you simply move, right? There's nothing special happening. I'm not attacking these minions. Nothing is happening. I'm not attacking Scholar. Nothing like that. If I attack move, you are going to attack anything between yourself and that targeted location on the ground. So you enable attack move by just simply hitting A. And if I click right there, I'm doing nothing. I've got no hands on the keyboard. Kinsu is going to town. He's missing some last hits, but he's going to attack everything in his way to get to that position that my cursor was at. Alternatively, from hitting just A, you can also shift right click. That's going to smart cast attack move. You can kind of see the difference in my cursor between when I'm shift right clicking and when I'm not. So as you can see, this is just normal right clicking. You see how my arrows are blue. When I shift right click, it turns to red. So you know that I'm auto attacking at that point. Okay, so the importance of shift right clicking and A clicking. It's kind of a preferential thing. I personally use A left click to last hit because it kind of gives me this nice targeting indicator. I like hovering over the minion and hitting at the last second, right? Shift right clicking I use more for when I actually do the kiting and whatnot. Moving on to kind of the animation canceling and how important the A left click and shift right click is to that whole concept is how to explain the characters have a wind up, an auto attack, and a wind down animation. With animation canceling or orb walking or kiting or whatever you want to call it, you actually cancel the wind down animation in that thing, but your auto attack still goes off. So, for example, I'm here doing this, doing my thing. I'm not being mobile right now. I'm simply attack moving behind the minions. I am a really easy target for skill shots. I am unsafe. Thanks for that poke. I appreciate that. I'm just completely unsafe. Like standing still, you're an easy target for skill shots. You're an easy target for ganks. You know, maybe you're not paying attention. Like you can kind of zone out if you just kind of auto attack move and you're like, all right, well, he'll farm this for a while until I get to that position. So that's cool. But I like being a little bit more active in lane, and I do that by doing the animation canceling. So this is how it's gonna kind of look. If you want to push out the lane a little bit, Scholar, that would actually work. Just E and use all your abilities and things like that. So what the animation canceling is gonna allow me to do is it's gonna be mobile, be active. I'm gonna be constantly having to pay attention in lane. And that's going to help me when it comes to team fights, because in team fights, I want to be always kiting and auto attack and animation canceling and stuff. So doing it in lane, this is just a personal thing. And if you want to adopt this as well, then I think it's really I think it's really important. But doing it in lane will just allow it to feel natural once the team fights actually happen. So I'm going to show an example whenever the creeps get here of how it works. So before, it was just A left click. I will move to that position and attack everything. So the animation canceling part is, as soon as Kinsu fires the arrow, I'm already moving to my next position. Does that make sense? I'm already going to that next position. I'm not just sitting there, constantly moving, just like this. So what that's doing is that it's minimizing my downtime. So I'm no longer that immobile target. See right there, Scholar, you know, probably maybe purposely missed his E on me. But I made it hard for him to hit. Scholar right now, if he's like sitting there and just auto-attacking, he's just an easy target, you know, if I can hit him. But he did a good job, obviously, moving out of the way of that one. But if especially if you're against someone that doesn't really do this very often in lane, you have a really nice empirical advantage of just your mobility versus theirs is so much higher that they're not going to expect it. They're going to be taken aback whenever you hit them with a nice E. And then all of a sudden your trades are far more effective. So I'm just going to do this for a little bit just to show what it's like just a little bit more. So auto move. And you do this by what I'm doing here is I'm A left clicking the target. And as soon as my arrow leaves my bow, I'm right clicking another place on the ground. Just like this. Just constantly moving. That's all it is. And I'll show you guys how, you know, this is obviously super important in a team fight and whatnot. See, this is just staying mobile. That's all I'm doing. Just like that. And of course he's using, and then of course Zakint shows up. What's up, Zakint? Now let's go. So we're both, you're above level 6, right? Okay, perfect. Let's go up here. Let's go to top money picks. George, if you want to come too, I think that'd be perfect. Thought it was some kind of abuse of the system. Nah, it's not. It's just a thing. Whoa. Let's relax. All right. So, the difference between kind of using animation canceling to kite and not is can be apparent by like, George, come close to me a little bit. Yeah, I'd be like right there. And I'm going to start auto-attacking George, and he's just going to run away from me. And we're going to see what happens by simply, I'm just going to attack move past George. And George, you want to start running? Let me actually get one auto off. Okay. So here, you see how he's slowed, but after a while, he does get out of my auto-attack range. That's because waiting for the downtime, kind of the cooldown, like I said, of my auto-attack animation, it puts me at a disadvantage because I'm not moving during that time. So let's do it one more time just to show. So again, I have level 4 of my slow arrows, which is slowing him for 30%. But because I'm not minimizing my downtime and moving effectively, he can still outrun me. So let's do it one more time. Just go for it. So he's getting slowed, but after a few autos, you see how he's gone. I will like never catch him again, which sucks. Unless I ulti, which is like, you know, right there. But, farewell, friend. So let's just see the difference between just attack moving past him and then trying to animation cancel right now. So we'll do the same thing, but I will employ animation canceling, and hopefully, you know, I'll be able to stay in range of him. So, George, you want to start running? I see you. So see how I'm doing this? I am still 100% in range of him at all times. I haven't increased my slow. I haven't done anything. I'm canceling some autos because I suck. But does it show how important it is? You know, does that make sense to you, Scholar?
Yeah.
Okay. So
I mean, it's obvious the difference. You get four auto attacks off on him the first time, and then
the rest
you
of the time
killed him the second time.
Exactly.
You kept chasing.
Exactly. So. I did do a few misclicks, and that's one of the things about trying to do animation canceling is that it's hard. It's a finicky thing because if you move before your arrow leaves, you completely cancel the auto. So if I'm like trying to do this, like I'm trying to animation cancel correctly here, but sometimes my arrow doesn't quite fire and I look like an idiot, right? The cool thing about Kinsu is that his resource bar shows how many arrows he has knocked, right? Up to a maximum of 2. So once you are recharging your arrows, you can kind of see, like, as soon as it crosses that halfway point, see, I did a little bit too early there. As soon as it crosses that halfway point, that's when I can fire another arrow. Kinsu makes it kind of easy in that respect to kite and animation cancel effectively. So thank you, George, for being our test dummy. But I would like to kind of see... Scholar, do you want to give it a shot?
Sure.
Okay, let's see. Go buy some armor and health. Okay. No, I want to see him do it on you, George. No, you can do it on me. Let me go. That's true, because you guys are on the same team. I am stupid. I'm gonna go buy some health and armor real quick, just so I don't die immediately. George, so smart, so intelligent. Pretty much the best. All right, I'm gonna buy some of these and some health potions. So it's quick intermission. I'm gonna blitz. But yeah, next time I'll show it on Zakint one more time and just explain the process of what I'm doing real quick, and then we'll have Scholar try his hand at it. And maybe he'll be a god at it. Maybe he'll be really good. I don't know. Do you have the confidence, Scholar?
I can try.
You can try. Okay. So one more time, let me do this on George. Let's do the non-animation cancel chase, and then we will do the correct one. It'll explain exactly what I'm doing every time. So A, left clicking George here. He's gonna run. Again, I have a 30% slow. See that speck among But because I'm not effectively animation canceling, I'm wasting precious time by winding down my auto attack. And we'll do it one more time, and I will do the correct kind of animation cancel, and I'll explain what I'm doing. So I am alternating between right click and A left click. So for example, I am always A left clicking him and then right clicking beyond him to keep moving. That keeps me mobile, that keeps me in the chase, and that keeps me, you know, hunting my prey. So we'll do it real quick. Let me get in range. All right, go for it. So A. It's super, you know, super easy, super basic. It takes a lot of practice, but once you get it down, it's super nice. He can no longer outrun me. I am now, you know, murdering George effectively, and I can use my W. One thing I really like about Kintsu is get back here. One thing I really like about Kintsu is just, you know, his stick potential. Like, I don't need a pursuit, I don't need a control, I don't need inevitability. I really like Kintsu's built-in kind of kiting here, and I can, this whole time, I don't have to be moving in a straight line. I could come to the side. He flipped me. I could come to the side, dodging skill shots. If I'm against, you know, like a Vianna, I can, you know, not get hit by her needle, stuff like that. But thank you, George, for being the test dummy. So, alternating between A left click and simple right click beyond the target is how you effectively chase someone down. And we'll go over kiting them chasing you in a second. But first, you know, let's give Scholar a chance to go ahead and try this. I want you to just chase me down.
First, I have a question.
Yeah, what's up?
How do you get used to alternating between two different buttons for a rhythmic action like that? Do you just practice until it becomes second nature?
Pretty
How
much.
How did you get used to that?
So, to go into the background, like, I've been playing MOBAs for a long time. I played Dota All-Stars, like, in middle school, and I switched from there to League of Legends. I played League for, you know, 3 years. I fell in love with kind of the AD carry role. Like, my favorite champions I used to play are, like, Vayne and Caitlyn and stuff. It's something that just, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of practice, but once it's kind of muscle memory, like, and I'll admit, I am the least rhythmic person you will ever meet. Like, I have zero rhythm. But I'm able to do it pretty effectively because of that muscle memory. I see Paper Crane is asking, you know, questions. Justin, obviously one of our online engineers, is like, why is that a thing? You know, why don't they just not have the wind down animation? And you know, I think it separates like skilled players from non-skilled players. You know, and maybe that's a false skill gap that shouldn't be there. You know, in some people's eyes, but I like it. You know, I think it's really fun. I think it's one thing about MOBAs that really makes me enjoy the genre. Like, I really enjoy the active gameplay of auto attack moving and attack, you know, animation canceling and stuff like that. But as far as, you know, how do you get good at it? It's practice, 100%. Like I said, doing it in lane while you're CSing puts you in that mindset. It gives you the practice outside of team fights so that whenever a team fight does happen, you're already doing it. Someone that's simply right-clicking and not doing it in lane phase, whenever it comes to that team fight that breaks out mid-game, they're going to be like, oh, now I have to switch modes and I have to go into this animation canceling and kiting mode. But if you're doing it lane, you're like, oh, I'm already there. I'm already, you know, one step ahead of you. Does that kind of answer your question? Just practice, really,
yeah.
Like most things. I learned to do it, you know, like playing Vayne and Caitlyn. Like I fell in love with AD carry. I ended up climbing, you know, rank to Diamond 1 in League and playing mostly Vayne and Caitlyn. And the skills that I learned there translated really well to Dawngate. And I fell in love with Kintsu whenever he was first a box man, you know, back in pre-development, whenever he didn't have animations, he didn't have a model or anything, but I fell in love with Kintsu's kit. I loved the idea of the utility. I loved his fear. I loved his W. I loved the built-in kite, all that kind of stuff, and I really, really enjoy it. So let's give you a shot to try it out on me. So you're in Frost Arrows, which is important, yeah. And I'm just going to run. Where should I run?
I also noticed that you bought a growth, so you're faster than I am.
Did I? No, I'm kind of an ass. I'll go sell that. Let me go sell this.
That's fine.
Hey, whoa, stop with the autos. I'm doing this for you, Scholar. I'm doing this for you. I just wanted to get some HP regen. I'm going to buy a bunch of lifes. How about that?
Just a quick heads up, you can also do this for melee shapers. So if someone is running away from you, you can also be attack canceling your like melee attacks.
Mm-hmm. It's not just ranged. It is not just ranged. I'm going to blitz back to you. Super fast cat now. All right. So yeah, let's see if you can keep up with me. I have the utmost faith, Scholar. You've seen me do it. I think you can do it.
I've died so many times trying to kite people, specifically bruisers. In MOBAs.
Well, with Kinsu, I really like the fact that, you know, he's got the built-in slow. It makes it really, really easy. But also building Pursuit on Kinsu makes you even more of a nightmare. So let's have you stand where I am right now, and we'll just go the same route.
Oh, shit. Sorry, I tried to right-click on where you were to move there.
Yeah, we'll go the same.
I forgot that you were on the enemy team.
I'll just run to the Spirit Well, pretty much. You ready?
Okay.
All right, here we go. There you go. Good. I mean, you stayed in my range pretty much the entire time, which was really, really nice. You could be a little quicker.
Yeah.
You could definitely just keep up with me, like, and you could even start, like, leading me practically. Like, I'm now getting in front of you. I'm cutting off your escape. And by doing that, I can force you to kind of go a different way. And if that way is like back into my team or something, then all of a sudden we're collapsing on you and, you know, we're murdering you, right? But yeah, let's actually try that one more time. Let me pop some potions. And just, again, especially as Kinsu, and I think Kinsu is a really good starter kind of animation canceler because of that resource bar I talked about. As soon as that bar fills at least a halfway, as soon as you do that A left click, you're going to fire an arrow, right? Like, and you know when you're not going to fire an arrow because that bar won't be halfway. So look at the bar, get the rhythm down, and just chase me down and murder me. I want to see you like get in front of me without using W, or at least get on top of me. Got it?
Okay,
all
I'll
right,
try.
Let's do it. Let me get back a little bit. Mm-hmm. Just like barely, just like go out of auto attack range and then go past me, like A left click me, and that'll be your max auto attack range, right? Do it right now. Okay, now that's where I want you to start. All right.
Okay.
Let us go. So get one auto off. Let's do it. There you go. See, you could be firing right there. See how that bar is halfway? Oh no!
You're just out of range.
Just out of range. Yeah. So I definitely, and hopefully you were able to spot it too. Your bar got up to like 3/4 completely full, and it should almost, when you're chasing someone down like this, it should almost never be there. As soon as it hits that halfway mark, I want you to fire an auto. All right.
Okay.
Do it one more time.
Just get to your max range. Click.
There you go. Perfect.
There we go. Max attack range.
All right. Get an auto off, and I'll start running. There you go. There you go. Keep moving. I'm getting away. I'm getting away. Oh no! All right, let's do it one more time. Let me try it on you.
Okay.
We'll see, and then hopefully you can just get another feel of it. George, get out of here. No one wants you, George. Do you have Q at rank 4?
Q, yeah.
Okay, good. All right, just making sure you have the same amount of slow that I have.
Yep.
All right. So I'm going to get into range. All right, ready?
Yes.
Let's do it. See how I'm like practically in front of you now?
Yeah.
Like that's just the difference between really just practice for one and but the stages of the animation canceling are like, against George, you saw when I was simply right-clicking, he ran away from me. What you're doing, I'm, like, able to barely get away from you, and whenever you're pretty good at it, like, I mean, not to toot my own horn or whatever, but, like, you can literally outrun people. Because, I mean, that should theoretically how it is, how it should be. If they're 30% slower than you, you should be able to be in front of them, or at least catch up to them, right?
Yeah.
But if you don't have the hang of kind of the animation cancel, you will not be able to catch up to them. And that's just kind of, you know, I know Justin Paper Crane was kind of talking about it. It's kind of just inherent in the genre. And that's what's a little bit rough. And of course, One Shot for All is asking, why aren't you weaving in damage cues in between? Because we're not to that part of the lesson yet. That makes it a little bit more crazy. Are you, Acute Lynx is pointing this out. Thank you so much. Where are you right clicking while you're chasing me? Are you right clicking past me?
Right next to you or right behind you?
Okay, let's try it this time. I want you to right click past me. So I want you to A left click me, right click past me, and then bring your mouse back. So you're gonna go back and forth pretty much. And I want to see if that makes any difference. And again, pay attention to your resource bar. And whenever it gets halfway, I want to see an arrow flying at my face. Okay?
Okay.
All right, let's try it one more time. Are you at max range?
Yes.
All right, let's go. There you go. Pass me, there you go. Keep moving, there you go. There you go, that's really good right there. Just keep chasing me. You're getting closer, that's good, I like it. I like to see you getting closer. Oh God, no, he's keep murdering me. There you go. See, as soon as it hits, yeah, you're doing really good now. I like that. I like that a lot. All right, good. Now don't murder me, please.
I'll try.
We'll do kind of, so I mean, it looks like you're definitely getting the hang of it, and I like to see that improvement, obviously. The inverse is also true. And Celeste is pointing out as well, you know, I am reading chat, guys, so, you don't have to always wait for your double auto, right? Like,
yeah.
Don't always expect to get it off. Like, when I'm chasing you or if I'm chasing George right now, like, if I'm doing this, I'm not really waiting for my double auto. I'm just always launching it as soon as my single auto is kind of off cooldown, right? You can also, one thing that might help you is you can A, left click, you can attack move past them. You can attack move past them, and as soon as your auto comes off cooldown, if you're in range, you will attack them. So you don't always have to be perfect with hitting them. That's why I use the A left click. That's why I use attack move, because if I don't click on them exactly and precisely, I'm still gonna get that auto off. So I'm gonna chase George down again, and I'm actually gonna kind of keep my mouse in one place. I'm gonna be moving past him and auto attack moving past him rather than on top of him, and I should be able to get the same effect. So George, you want to start running? I'm keeping my mouse, I don't know if you're watching the stream, but I'm keeping my mouse in one place. The danger that this runs into is exactly what just happened. It's not ideal in a team fight because when you auto attack move, you're going to attack the closest person to you. So as soon as you came into range, like if I want to kite down George, like George come back, like you stand right there, Scholar. If I'm doing this and I'm not perfectly clicking on him, I'm clicking past him right now. As soon as you're the closest target, I'm going to start attacking you. And that's not what I want. And now George has gotten away scot-free. Granted, you'll probably be dead, but maybe you're not the target I want, you know? And that's the importance of, like, precisely clicking them as opposed to clicking in the general area or just past them. So, again, it's all about rhythm. It's all about mouse control. It's all about accuracy. Sometimes before I play, there's this fun little flash game that I play. That I'll actually link to chat right now because I have it bookmarked and it's super fun. It's this invisible cursor game, and I really like to play it. You have to click on plates quickly before time runs out, and every time you click a plate, you get more time, but your cursor is completely invisible. And it really helps me just, like, because when a cluster crazy team fight breaks out, you can't always precisely see your cursor, right? So having the feel of where it is super important. That is pretty much kiting someone or chasing down someone. The inverse of that is going to be not allowing someone to touch you, right? Like that's super important. So you're going to be doing that by the exact opposite. So rather than clicking past them or towards them, you're going to be clicking away from them, and you're going to be A left clicking or shift right clicking, whether you want to smart cast it or not, away from them, and you're going to be alternating the same way. So if George runs at me, oh God. If George runs at me, I'm going to be moving backwards. It's a little bit more difficult just because you do have to cover more ground with your cursor if there's no one else around. So right now, you see, I'm just doing this. Like, George, at this rate, will, like, never catch up to me, right? Like, he is just going to be slowed for days. He's super tanky and beefy because I hate him. But yeah, goddamn. But this is how it should look. Like, bruisers, when you're playing Kintsu, if they don't have a gap closer, should, like, never be able to touch you. And every time it gets halfway, I'm firing another arrow. But as you can see, you can kind of see whenever I screw up because my auto attack doesn't properly go off. But he shouldn't be able to touch me, right? Like, I am ranged. He is melee. I have slow. He does not. So this is exactly what you want to see. And what I'm doing there is I am right-clicking backwards, and because he's the only target that's in range, I can keep my mouse backwards and smart cast or a left click. But if I was trying to do that, like, when you were around, I would, like, start kiting, like, George, go south a little bit. If I was not targeting him specifically, and I was running away, smart casting, trying to kite him away, like, come towards me, all of a sudden, I'm kiting the wrong person, you know? Like, he has to be the only target for that strategy to work. If he's not, I might slow the wrong person, and you don't want that, because that could be the difference between life and death, and that's not good at all, right? Let's have you try it, the same concept. I'm going to come at you. I'm not going to be attacking you from range, obviously, but if I get in melee range of you, then we'll assume that you would be dead, okay?
Okay.
All right, let's try that. Ready? Boop, boop, boop. Oh god. Yeah, you'd pretty much, that was good use of the W, but the W is really good. I really like it about Kintsu because it gives you that, it gives you the breathing room, right? Like, if you mess up one and all of a sudden they're on top of you, you can W over a wall or W away from them or just put more distance. It's almost like a get out of jail free card. Kind of cheating, but I really like the use of that skill. So let's try it one more time. I want to try to get in melee range of you. So let's go ahead and do it. You ready?
Yep.
All right, let's go. I'm running. There you go. There you go. That's perfect. See how you waited super long on that one?
Yes.
You don't try. Yeah, try not to wait on it. Let's just, as soon as it's halfway, or like, I'll give you the breathing room of a little bit over halfway. I want that arrow in my face. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Let's try it again. There you go. Perfect. Nice. Oh, you're waiting so long. All right. Do it again. There you go. I don't want to see your bar get full. I don't want to see it, Scholar. Oh god, I'm Cerulean, you might be dead. Alright. No, that was better though. Oh my god, what are you doing? I am so low. No, but I mean that was good. I think you're doing a great job. Kintsu, I think you should definitely try him out and continue playing him because that resource bar is super important. Like once you switch to a Mikella or Varian or someone, you're not gonna have that kind of you can almost see it like a hint. Yeah, it's an indicator. With every other range carry, it's going to have to become muscle memory. You're going to have to, you know, like, and the interesting thing about this whole process is that it scales and changes with attack speed, right? So, like, late game, you're going to have, yes, George, thank you. Late game, you're going to have more haste than you do early game, right? So your auto attacks are going to be faster, so you're going to be able to kite faster, but you're also going to have to be more active. You're gonna have to keep up with it because if you're not keeping up with it, you're not outputting the correct damage, right? You're putting out less damage than you should be. Sometimes in that case, it is better to just simply right click and maybe not completely worry about kiting and stuff. Like if a team fight is breaking out and no one is coming for you, like their Cerulean isn't ulting into your face, sometimes it's honestly better just to like right-click past them, and you will murder the team fight. Like, if you have, like, Fate, Vengeance, Kintsu, all of a sudden their entire team is dead, and you didn't have to do anything, right? Except for a left-click. The other thing George is saying that I will point out, Scholar, if you want to come over to, like, where I am, George, you want to go in that brush by Money Pigs? The other thing that we kind of wanted to point out, just go in the brush, whatever. Some people don't do this. Some people don't know this. Let's say I was chasing George into that brush, and he's trying to juke me with that brush. If I simply am like, oh, I want to right-click him. Where is he? Oh, all of a sudden he went over here. I could have lost him right there, 100%, just because I was right-clicking. If you use the A left-click or shift right-click into a brush, as soon as he becomes visible to me, I will auto-attack him. Regardless of where he is, I don't have to have the accuracy of right-clicking him specifically. So right now, I'm going to A move into this brush. As soon as he becomes visible, my character will start attacking. And boom, the chase is on, right? Otherwise, he could have juked me really effectively like that. It's a very important tactic, and it's kind of just form the habit, just same as kind of animation canceling. Every time I enter a brush where I think that anyone could possibly be, I shift right-click into the brush. Because if someone's in there, I want to attack them immediately. I don't want them to get away. I don't want to be taken by surprise. I want to murder them. So one more time, George, just to show the difference. So I'm going to right-click into this brush and try to click George as fast as possible. But he could very well juke me. So here we go. Right-click into the brush. Where is he? Oh, God. He's gone. I could not catch him. But doing it again, you in there? Okay. I'm going to A left-click into the brush, and hopefully I should get my first auto off. Yeah, see? Boom. So he came out of the exact same spot. I entered at the exact same spot, but because I was attack moving into the brush, you saw how that first auto immediately hit him, right?
Yeah.
That's how it should be. Let's see. What else is there? And then, of course, someone kind of joked in chat, why was I not alternating between between damage and slow. So this is kind of the super high level Kinsu. It's really hard to do. I'm not even amazing at it. But his Q has a 1 second cooldown, and the slow from his Ghost of Despair has a 2 second duration. So theoretically, in a perfect world, you can switch between Despair and Malice every auto attack and never miss a beat. And still be able to kite them. So I'm going to try to do it on George. I'm not very good at it. But Scholar, if you want to come over near Money Pigs, just so I don't F up too hard. I will try to kite George, and I'll try to switch between autos, but it might not work out. I'm pretty bad at it. But yeah, that's kind of the highest level of Kinsu play. Theoretically possible. So let's do it, George. Oh, no. Use that. All right, let's keep going.
That looked a lot better.
Yeah, with a little bit more attack speed, it would be a little bit easier since I pretty much have. What's that? Oh, you have a fluidity? What an ass! All right, whatever. So I think I could have worked better if George did not have a fluidity, but he's kind of an ass and he took fluidity, so. I hate you, George. What else is there about Kinsu? I mean, is there any other questions you have about Kinsu or about being a ranged carry or anything like that I can help you with?
I think with Kinsu, one of the things that we noticed in this session is that when I was trying to move and attack you, I would too often just use both attacks.
Mm-hmm.
Because I wasn't reacting fast enough to cancel the second attack before moving.
Mm-hmm.
Since it's basically an auto, he has an automatic auto attack reset if he has both arrows knocked.
Yeah.
So, I need to get faster at that so I can start moving again as soon as the first arrow goes off.
Mm-hmm.
And that might actually help me learn to cancel the animations more reliably, because if you don't do that on Kinsu, you're going to get your second arrow off, and you don't always want to do that if you're chasing somebody.
Yeah, especially if you're chasing someone, because it's at that point, like if you're chasing someone down, it's better to have them slowed than to put out X more damage, right? Like you don't want to lose a step. Because if I'm double arrowing George every time he tries to walk away, that's the same as just right-clicking, and he gets away, right? But if he comes back, and I'm doing that one arrow, the first one can be double, but as soon as I get another arrow every time, I'm hitting George, right? If I'm waiting in this time, it's not worth it at all. Like, look, he's getting away again. I don't want George to get away, but if I wait, he's going to get away. And maybe there's autos off, but eventually, especially with his stupid fluidity, George, you son of a bitch, he's gonna get away. Other Kinsu things, the Voidbreaker Ultimate, the fear is based on the distance traveled. So if George is on me, if he's like on top of me, just come auto me, George. And let's say, you know, like he's a little bit squishier, I have more damage, I have the chance to kill him. At this point, ulting right now is going to do a quick 0.5 second stun, and that's going to be like nothing, you know, especially at this range. I'm not going to be able to get to a good distance to kite him. He's just going to murder me. So before using my ulti, I would recommend getting to a further range just to increase the fear duration with my W, right? So, like, if you can put yourself at a further range, do it. If I'm chasing George, for example, and I can, I'm like catching up to him and stuff, which is like what like I should be doing or like I want to be doing, especially since he has a freaking fluidity. Before I ulti, I might want to put myself on the other side of him to get max distance, max fear, and also to, you know, deter his path. Like, he's not going to want to come through me anymore, especially if he's super low. And considering my my damage E has an execute component, I use that a lot to reposition, to get that nice shot off that I may miss otherwise from my current position. Use the targets of your W to put you in a position to be able to hit people with your E, right? And one of the things about range carries is, like, I don't know, 90% of your damage is from your auto attacks. Like, you want to be auto attacking as much as possible in a team fight. It is of the utmost importance. I think Scholar may have just... Are you still there, George? You're muted or something. Or maybe the call did legitimately just drop. Okay, cool.
I'm here.
Okay, good. You dropped for a second. But you want to be auto attacking as much as possible in a team fight. So much so that some characters, Kinsu included, it's almost not worth to use your abilities, right? I mean, like, the ulti, obviously, if you get a fear off, amazing, do that. But the ulti does have a short cast time to it. The E does have a short cast time to it. That's time that I'm not auto-attacking, and that's time that I'm not outputting my highest possible damage. The only time I use my E in a team fight is Frost, or, like, Despair, I think it is, to slow a lot of people if we need it. And B, if someone that I want to kill with my damage E is out of auto attack range. Because obviously, my E has a much... Just stay right there. My E... Stay right there. Don't move, George. My E has a much longer range than my auto attack. Like, that's two auto attack lengths right there. If I'm sniping someone with it and getting a kill, that's awesome. I will 100% use that. But as you can see, it does have a cast time. So if I'm like in a melee fight with George, which I almost never want to be in, it's not even worth it to like waste the time to get that E off. Because he, if he would die to an E at this range, he would probably die to a set of basic autos as well. You know, if I was far more fed or far more damage, I have three lives and two resiliences right now. And same with your ulti. Like, if the utility of putting, bringing that fear to the fight outweighs the fact that you are motionless for that, like, I don't even know what it is, maybe 0.5 seconds, 0.75 seconds of casting the ulti, then do it. But otherwise, honestly, I would hold on to the ulti. I use Kinsu's ulti as either an engage, a long-range engage, or as a point-blank, like, as soon as George ultis me, I might fire it off in his face just to get that little bit of distance, just to give me time to, like, blink or blitz or something, you know? Even though a Cerulean ulti into a straight flip, if I try to ulti first, he's going to flip me every time because my ulti has that cast time, right? So if a Cerulean is ulting you, I highly recommend blitzing first to give you immunity to his flip, and then maybe ulting if you need to, or just kiting from then on out. Is there any other questions that you have about Kinsu or ranged carry in general?
Ranged carries in general, specifically items.
Okay.
Like, a lot of the time, if there's a fed bruiser on the enemy team and I'm playing ranged carry, I'll be like, I need to be able to... If I already do enough damage, I'll need to be able to kite more.
Mm-hmm.
What items would you recommend for...
I
need to be able to kite better in this situation, or I'll just die.
I love Pursuit, especially the new Pursuit. Like Pursuit at one point in time before Itempalooza, kind of skippable. I didn't absolutely love it, but new Pursuit I really really love, and it's for one main reason. It slows them, which I mean, like obviously you know it's a control item, so you know that makes sense. But also the fact that it speeds you up, gives you a little bit more breathing room. You know, like. If I bought Inevitability, sure, it'd be a heavier slow on them, but sometimes me being faster is the difference between me dodging a skill shot or not in a team fight, and that could be the difference between life and death. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I really, really love Pursuit. So I have Pursuit now. George, obviously, with his fluidity, still maybe can outrun me. I don't know. We're going to find out. But it makes it a little bit easier for me to keep up with him because every auto, I'm faster, and he is exponentially slower. So, George, you want to run? So now it's like just so much easier, right? He will never get away from me, and I can outrun him for days, even though I canceled that auto. Oh well. And I have a little bit more attack speed too. I love Pursuit as an item. I buy it on pretty much any range carry that I play. So Pursuit 100%. I love it. As far as other items are concerned. Kinsu, I really love Fate. I love Fate on Kinsu. It's really fun to just use your W to shred like an entire team and then pretty much have your pick of the litter of like where you want to go with your W. What else do I like to build? Vengeance is a kind of a interesting item because it's going to give you a lot of health, which is always good. It's going to give you a little bit of armor. It's going to give you a little bit of power. And if you couple it with Fate, it's absolutely hilarious. We call it the Michael Bay build in internally because it's super fun. But yeah, Fate, Vengeance, Pursuit, really, really nice. Rage is almost a necessity when it comes to late game. Justice is also really nice. Dominance, I really love. If I go Dominance, I'm almost always going to go Resonance as well because Resonance and Dominance just have such good synergy. I mean, you have 25 mastery on Resonance. You've got 20 mastery on dominance. That's a 45% crit chance right there because mastery for an 80 carry is a 1-to-1 crit chance kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then I love ambition personally as my life drain item. Great power, great haste, great armor. The life drain based on missing health is also really strong. You can kind of bait people out. Like they're like, oh, he's super low. All of a sudden you're gaining a crap ton with every auto. Mostly for ambition, though, I really enjoyed Desire. Desire is an incredible advanced tier item. 10 power, 30 armor, and 10% life drain, coupled with my, you know, the loadout that I run with 11 armor. That brings me up to 41 armor. That's potentially 41 armor I have over the enemy range carry. I shouldn't be taking a lot of damage, and I should be able to kite them and murder them, hopefully. But yeah, Desire is a fantastic advanced tier item. I usually get that maybe like second or third item. And then as far as time is concerned, Finesse is one of my favorites, especially if I go like Fate, Betrayal, Finesse, Kinsu, you will wreck everything. Especially with the recent buff to Finesse, it got a little bit, it got the exploit weakness percent damage increase, got buffed I think by like 2% at every stack, which is huge. So my end game build on Kinsu, I really like Ambition, Finesse, Betrayal, Fate, Rage, and if they have a lot of health, if they're building a lot of health, Ruin is a fantastic item choice. Otherwise, maybe like a Justice, or if you do need more armor, Preservation is a really, really nice item to have because that ablative armor, you gain 5 stacks of ablation, increasing your power by 6 per stack for a total of 30 bonus power, and if you get hit by an enemy shaper, it removes a stack. So effectively, you know, you do get less power if you get hit, but as a range carry, theoretically, if you're doing well, you shouldn't be getting hit. So you're going to keep that 30 power bonus the entire time, which is a really, really nice armor item for range carries. If I need a magic resist item, obviously Betrayal is far and away my favorite thing. If I'm playing against someone that's super bursty, however, like if I'm playing against a Zaugus or like a Kindra or something or an Amaranth that's super bursty, I may go for a Faith instead because Faith gives you that huge magic damage shield up front, which is really nice. I mean, 375 magic damage shield
Yeah.
Is really, really good against those burst characters. It doesn't give you as much damage output as a Betrayal, but sometimes you just need to survive. You know, sometimes that's your goal in a teamfight, is just survive and deal out as much damage as possible. Because in a teamfight, if your range carry, whether that's you or someone else, stays alive longer than their range carry, your team should be able to win the fight. Because range carries have the highest sustained potential damage output at the end of the game, right? So sometimes you have to you know, kind of spec into your own survivability. And if you do that earlier than their range carry, and you're surviving team fights better, you should be golden. But yeah, I usually like to go one defensive item. If I'm feeling super ham or I'm super fed, I can go 6 offensive items and pray that I can just outplay the enemy. But yeah, one defensive item, whether it's preservation, whether it's betrayal or faith, is kind of up to what the team comp and how we're doing looks like, right?
Yeah.
And then the last thing that I'll leave people with, because this happens so often in MOBAs that I really, really hate, especially as a range carry player, is don't yell at your range carry for attacking the tank. 100%. George is laughing about that because he knows it's true. Range carries should attack whoever is closest to them. 100%. If their range carry puts themselves in a position where I can safely auto them and they're not paying attention to me, sure, focus them, auto them, and kill them. Because if they die, then we win the fight and it's easy peasy. But I shouldn't be the one making that mistake to put myself in the fire range of the enemy AD carry. That sounds like a mouthful, but does that make kind of sense?
Yeah.
If you're
in within an auto attack range of their back line, then that means their front line is on top of you.
Exactly. And that's not good. Don't be the carry that makes the mistake. You want to be the AD carry of the game that is attacking the right targets. And by right targets, I just mean the closest people to you. Like whether it's a big fed Cerulean, you have to kill him if you want to safely be able to kill the rest of his team. A fed Cerulean, super scary, obviously, but if you ignore that fed Cerulean and try and simply like right-click the enemy AD carry in the back line, that fed Cerulean is going to murder you, and you're going to be dead, 100%. So players out there, don't get angry if a range carry attacks the tank. He should 100% be attacking the person closest to him. As long as they're hit, exactly, music hit said it right. Don't care who my AD carry is hitting as long as they're hitting someone. I couldn't have said it better myself. That is absolutely perfect. Because theoretically, in a perfect team, you will have someone peeling for you as the range carry. So, like, that Cerulean's rushing at you, you're auto-attacking, all of a sudden your own Cerulean, your own Reyna, someone comes up, peels that Cerulean off of you, and all of a sudden you have an easier time kiting him, easier time killing him, focusing him, and all of a sudden you guys have steamrolled the team fight and done a good job and won the game, hopefully, and killed the Guardian. So, Music Hit, thank you for that. Don't care who my AD carry is hitting, as long as they're hitting someone. Hashtag AD carry life. So don't get mad at your AD carries, please, guys. But I think that about does it. I hope you've learned something, Scholar. I hope you're coming out of this with some newfound knowledge.
Well, I got a little bit of practice in, and I did notice that I was clumsy every time, but I was slightly less clumsy as it went on. I was able to stay closer to you.
Good.
And if I had built, like, a pursuit, then I might have been better.
Yeah, 100%. You probably could have murdered me. Are you guys just going to murder me to end the show? Wow. What about just going, cut the tape! No one look! But yeah, hopefully you guys out there in Twitch chat have been able to take away some stuff from this lesson. Hopefully I have taught someone out. If I have taught at least one person out there something, then I feel like I've done my job. But I appreciate all of you guys for tuning in to this first, or the Coaching Gate less one-on-one lesson in 2 weeks. So 2 weeks from today, I think George will be doing a lesson with Dibs. He climbed to rank 3 on the leaderboards playing tank Dibs, and it is the most annoying thing you've ever played against. And he'll teach you how to do it as well in 2 weeks' time. So take a look out, keep an eye out, rather, for the Reddit thread that'll appear, let's see, June 30th. That's going to be the Monday before the lesson. That's when we'll post the Reddit threads. We'll choose a winner on Tuesdays. And yeah, Scholar, thank you so much for being our guinea pig. I really appreciate it.
No problem. Thanks for teaching me.
Of course, of course.
I'm going to try to put that into practice now.
I hope to see you in game kiting effectively as Kinsu or any AD carry, and it's going to bring a tear to my eye and be like, oh, So good. I taught him so well. But that's it. That brings us to an end. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/AdonGate, and facebook.com/AdonGate. I'm actually get out of the Skype call real quick, so I'll talk to you very soon, Scholar, okay?
All right.
Thank you, guys. Bye.
Thank you.
So, yeah, that was hopefully a lesson that you guys can take something away from. Range carry, playing Kinsu, animation canceling, kiting, all that sweet, sweet stuff. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/AdonGate, and facebook.com/AdonGate. Hit that follow button down below. You get notified every time we go live. And if you enjoyed this, I know Spinal Dash is in chat. Go check him out at 6 p.m. Is that when he starts? No, 6 p.m. Eastern, I believe. So 3 p.m. PDT. Correct me if I'm wrong, Spinal. But I believe it's 3 to 6 PDT and 6 to 9 EST. He does kind of the same one-on-one coaching, calls it the Wednesday Dash. Go check him out. It's really, really fantastic. And, yeah, you can find him at twitch.tv/SpinalDash. But let me see if there is... Who else is stramming the Dawn Gate right now? You guys should go check out. Boop, 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 boop. Go check out... You want to go see Blind Craziness? He's a beast. Or Cute Links is streaming right now. Go check out Cute Links, guys. 6 p.m. Eastern, I am right. Go check out Cute Links. He's streaming right now. He's probably watching the video. Go rate him. Tell him we sent you. And go watch his stream. But again, thank you guys so much for watching. I appreciate it. And we'll see you guys next time, which will be tomorrow at noon for some gameplay with George, I believe. So see you guys. Bye.
They go no further.
Put them in the ground.